Hi everyone, thank you for joining me. This is the Modern Maker Workroom, and this lesson is about the falda yin, which is a 16th and 17th century petticoat, typically worn directly over the shift or chemise. It's not a garment that would be seen on the outside. This is a kind of an underwear garment. The construction that we're going to show in this series of videos is based on the construction techniques that are used to make them for Spanish traditional dress, like as a regional costume. So the construction techniques are old. They have come through several hundred years. There aren't any surviving versions of this garment in museums, so it's really hard to know for sure exactly how they're made, but this is a very close approximation, I believe, to what was actually done. The things that you'll need are about 2 yards or 1.8 meters of 60 inch wide fabric for the main body of the garment. Now I will be using wool. This can be made with silk, although silk tends to be very, very light. It'll still serve as a petticoat, but it'll act more like a slip, I think, than it would as a warm petticoat. You will also need a couple of yards of fabric for the trim and the bindings. The trim ends up being about 2 to 2.5 inches/5 centimeters wide, and the binding will finish at about 3/8 of an inch. That is usually in a contrasting color. You can make it the same color if you'd like, maybe a different texture instead. I don't recommend using a velvet trim for your first time around on this project. It can be very difficult to work with. There's one other piece of fabric. We'll use a heavy wool melton for the facing at the hem. And this is a hem stiffener, and it goes around the entire bottom edge of the skirt to give it a lot of body so that it moves and swings in a beautiful way as it's worn. Now this skirt is cut as a half circle so that it has some beautiful radiating folds and yet is still quite flat where it meets the waist. And that makes it great for layering underneath a lot of clothes. The first thing we're going to do is the layout. And you'll see that I've already got the lines drawn on the fabric, and that's just so that I need to do less explanation for you. I will tell you exactly how each line is laid out, but I also want you to be able to see what the layout is as we're doing it so that each line makes sense. We begin with the cut edge of the fabric to our right. We're going to work right to left in laying this garment out. The typical rule is you put the widest end of the garment toward the cut edge of the fabric because it wastes less fabric that way. So in this instance, we have a huge hem because it's a half circle. So we put that hem against the cut edge. I'll begin by making a mark right here, and then I'll lay the length of the front in place. Now the length of this skirt, if you'll refer to your diagram, the length of the skirt is 1¼ vara. Now the way that we lay that out is we will place the 0 on the mark that we make here, and we'll lay the tape out along the fold, and we see our vara mark right here, the letter B, and then we're going to swing this tape around and we're going to line the Q up with the B, adding an additional quarter to the length. That's where we'll make our mark, and that tells us where the waistline begins. So the next thing we'll need is then to mark these lines right here in order to draw the waistline. And for that, we'll need to use the waist tape. So I'll set the length tape aside over here. We'll come back to it in a moment. And I will place the 0 end of the waist tape right at that mark that I made delineating the front. And then I will measure 1 dedo less than M. So on your diagrams, it should say W-IM. The I being before the M means that it is 1 less than M. It reads like Roman numerals. So if I've got the 0 here, then I will shift the 0 to the 1, and then I can make a mark right at M, which makes it nice and clear, so you're not guessing where that mark should go. It just gives you a spot to mark off of very clearly. And we'll use that exact same measurement to plot this way. So I have IM, and that's where I will make the mark for the waist here. Once that's complete, then I'll want to draw the waistline. And the easiest way to do that is to treat this tool like a compass. So I'll put my chalk on my tape, or put my tape on my chalk like this, so that there's a little corner sticking out. If you're using a pencil to draw this out, same principle. You can place the end of the pencil right on that zero. Here's a pencil. You'll just place the tape on the pencil and you'll hold it in place, just like so. I'm doing this with chalk, so I'm gonna bring my chalk back into play. And then I will lay this corner right on the mark that I made. Plant my thumb here at the corner along the fold, and then I will use this as a compass to cast the curve of the waist. And that gives us this beautiful, perfect curve. It gives us something clean to measure off of to get the length of the rest of the skirt. And that is using your tools wisely. That's the only thing that we need the waist tape for. We're going to return now to using the length tape. Before we move on, before we move on to this section up here, we'll need to finish marking out the hem of the skirt. And to do that, we'll measure perpendicular to this waistline. Since we know it's an actual half circle, then all lengths from the waistline to the hem, if they're measured perpendicular to the waistline, those should all be 1 1/4 vada. So we'll begin by using the same technique, and I'm measuring this as perpendicular as possible to this little segment of the waistline right here. So this should be a 90 degree angle where the tape is. So I'm going to go bada, and then I'm going to swing the end of the tape around, line the Q up with the B, and then make a mark at zero. And I will do this several times along this portion of the fabric from here to here, and then connect the dots with the chalk. In order to do this smoothly, I recommend, instead of trying to draw carefully or work from this side, stand at the edge of the table. I've got my hip right against the edge of the table. If you're doing this on the floor, it's going to be a little bit more awkward, but you can still use a similar technique. I'm going to plant my chalk, and then I'm just rocking back with my body rather than trying to draw with my arm and hand. This is all kept quite rigid so that I just rock backwards and it smoothly draws that curve in place. And that way when I'm cutting, I'm not fighting a jagged line to try to guess what the smoothest direction is. Okay, now I'm going to shift the fabric down so that I can start showing you how to draft the center back and the gore that attaches to this portion. Before I do though, we'll need to measure this line right here because we need that measurement in order to draft the section that goes over here, okay? So the easiest thing to do is take your chalk, give yourself a visual guideline for the seam allowance. You can't cut right to this edge because that's not where you're sewing. That's part of the seam allowance. You're sewing here to the inside of that selvage. And the selvage is an already finished edge, so why damage it? Why cut it off? We want to keep it so that when we're sewing together, we have that much less finishing to do at the end of this garment. So I've marked myself a little bit of a line here. I'm going to take my length tape and I'm just going to measure the same way that we plotted out the center front. I can use the same technique to measure what this distance is. So I'll place the zero here. I'll measure to the B, and then I'll swing the tape around. And I have B plus T plus 1 1/2 dedo. So I'll write that as L, so I know I'm using the length tape, dash B T half. And half is just written 1/2, like a normal fraction. And I will write that directly on the fabric so that I have a very quick reference and can just look right at it when I need to draw the next portion of the garment. Okay, give me just a moment. Let me shift this fabric down. We have our waistline curve. I've talked about drawing the waistline curve. We've drawn all of that.
Now, I didn't mention that we should just draw a straight line all the way across here. So take your ruler, and you are going to start with the top of that little triangle that we cut for the waist, or we drew for the waist, and you'll follow it along all the way to the far edge. This is the center back of the garment right here, and I've labeled it CB for center back. The next thing we need to do is measure this length so that we know how much more we have to cut in order to complete the length of the garment. So I'll lay the tape measure down, zero at my seam allowance mark here, and then to this waist mark here, which is M plus half. So that's half the length of the tape plus half a dedo. So I'll document that again by writing directly onto the fabric L, M, half. That tells me that it's half the vada plus half a dedo. So whatever remains after this is taken away from 1 1/4 vada, that's the length that has to be drawn for the remainder of the seam. Now, if these were paper patterns, the trunk of the main body of the skirt will be over here, and I would have a wedge-shaped pattern piece over here, and I would butt them right up next to each other. Remember that for the most part, seam allowances are already included in these pattern measurements, so you don't have to worry about leaving a margin between the pieces. They can come right next to each other, and it helps conserve fabric. So this line that we drew, which was essentially the final line of this pattern piece, is now the first line that we've drawn of the wedge that we have to cut to match up to this. So I'm measuring here, I have 1 1/2. Now I know that I need vada and 1/4. So now I'm going to put that same mark here, and I have my vada there. And now I swing the end around so that I know where the 1/4 is. And that is the length of the piecing that needs to go on. Now I take that measurement that I made along the far side, along the selvage, and I'll measure from here out to this point, and that gives me the full width of this wedge. Now, when we did that measurement, it was 1 vada plus 1/3 plus 1 1/2 dedo. So we'll just mark all of those out one at a time. Vada here, then 1/3 is here, and then 1 1/2 dedo is to here. And then we know exactly what that piece should be shaped like. Now, all that remains is for me to draw this curve along the hem. Now, I've eyeballed this. If you're working with a paper pattern, you're going to cut your paper pattern or have something to trace off of to be able to get this curvature. So I just hand drew this curve, and I start by doing a little bit of a dotted line here, a little bit of a dotted line here, and I will just draw them until they match up and I can see a nice smooth line. The next thing we're going to do is cut this skirt out, but before we do, we want to make sure that the layers are pinned together carefully. Now, anyone who's worked with me before or read my first book, you know that I am obsessed with pinning layers together properly. The thing that drives me the craziest, and I don't mean to sound preachy about this, is if you put the pin straight into the fabric and then turn it to try to put it through, it shifts the layers, because you're literally taking this pin and shifting the layers as you go in. So when you pin the layers together, keep the pin as flat to the surface as possible and insert. This is called a tailor's roll. It's just a piece of wool felt that's been rolled up real tight. And then I have sewing needles in one end and pins in the other end. It should not be so big that it can't be held easily in the hand. Your fingers can still work. You've got everything easy access. Here are my scissors. Yes, they are big. The general rule of thumb with scissors is that when your hand is relaxed, 3 fingers go into the big loop, the thumb goes into the small loop, and the index finger should be on or behind the nut. It's not good for your hands to insert all four fingers into the large loop. It's much more natural to hold the scissors like so. This line dividing the two pieces is the first one that I always cut when I'm cutting out this particular garment. It's easy to cut accurately. It reduces the weight of the two pieces of fabric dragging against each other, which can affect how accurately your cut is made. Okay, everything's pinned. Let me finish the cut. And done. One thing I usually do when I have anything that's going across center is I will clip a tiny little notch. When I say tiny, I mean tiny. And this lets me know where the center is. Center back has a seam, pretty easy to identify. But center front, once this is all pressed over days of working and hand sewing it together, I may lose a fold that defines center front. So by putting a notch here and here, I will always have marks by which I can chalk in a straight line for center front if I need to. Here we have some heavy coat weight wool. This is a herringbone twill. It doesn't have to be a herringbone twill. It can be whatever kind of fabric is available to you, but it needs to be a fairly heavy wool. It needs to be a little bit fulled and felted so that it's got some good body to it. What we're gonna do is we will mark off little widths of it. And this is for the hem stiffener. And the fastest way to do it with a wool like this is really just to tear it. If you're not strong enough, of course you can cut it, but most of the time a wool like this should be fairly easy to tear. I prefer to mark these with my hand, so that I have a nice width. So I'll just lay my hand down along here and it'll be nice and consistent. You can go with three finger widths. Two is a little bit too narrow. I would not suggest using two fingers. Three fingers minimum for the width of the hem stiffener. Okay, next thing I will do is I'll take my scissors and I'll snip through the selvage at each one of these marks. And that starts the tear. And by tearing them, I know that they're clean and straight. And it's also very fast. And I do like speed. The next thing we'll do is we'll take this piece of silk. This is going to become our bias tape along the edge for our binding, and this will also become pieces of bias silk that we're going to be using for decoration. So the quickest thing to do is make sure that we can start our diagonal line on a good true bias. Now in period they would probably have just cut this out of some scrap fabric and it may or may not have been on true bias, but since our fabric is much less expensive per yard compared to an historical textile, I feel like this is, it's fine for us to work on cutting it on true bias. So what we'll need to do to get true bias, to find a real 45 degree angle, we'll measure down one side a certain amount and we'll measure down another side that same amount so that we have an exact 45 degree angle. And we have a nice 45 degree angle line to start off with. For the main body strips that we're going to be using to decorate the skirt, not the bindings, those will all come out of the center section, which is much longer. So we'll have fewer piecings around the decorative parts. The bindings, which go around the edge, can be smaller and narrower. So we're gonna cut those out of the corners of this piece of fabric so that we're keeping the longest pieces for the main body of the skirt for decoration. So I usually cut the bindings at 2 inches wide. So I'm going to use my 2-inch wide ruler here.
One, two, three. We'll do five here. So now we have a nice chunk of bias for bindings. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to double this width. So this is 2 inches. That gives us approximately a 3/8 inch finished binding. And you'll see how that goes on. It's double folded multiple times so that it's a nice stiff edge. But for the decorative strips, we're going to use 4 inch wide. So that's 10 centimeters for those of you in metric land. And so for that, I'll make a few marks that I can use as guidelines. I'm using a slightly finer pair of shears. These are great for cutting heavy wools, but they tend to fold the silk up in the blades because they're heavy. So I'm switching to a smaller, finer scissor. These, since none of these are going to be part of a main garment that's delicately fit, I'm not that concerned with pinning the layers together. These are all just trimmings, so the level of accuracy is somewhat lower than when we're cutting out an actual piece of clothing.